genome, that the genome sequencing should be incorporated in order to identify organisms. So is it able to incorporate genome data in this GBF?
So is genome trying to incorporate genomic data, is your question? There's a standard, there are standard places, databases in the world where you go and you will upload your genomic information, like GenBank, right? Yes. So there's a place in the world where that type of information goes. And there's a place in the world where eventually all biodiversity information will go. And we want to provide cross linkages between those two places. Now, GenBank, NCBI, those places are more capable of holding sequence data. We are more capable of holding broader information about the species, spatial data. So what we try to do is we try to link between the species and GBIF, and you know, its genomic information inside GenBank. So those linkages will exist if we have stable identifiers between one and the other. So if I publish, I don't know, a specimen in GBIF, I can include its accession number in my data set so that the researcher can say, okay, this specimen, it's been added to GenBank, and I can find out its genetic information. Does that answer your question?
I wanted to throw a challenge to BITC. You are telling us to come up with ways of setting up our GBIFs on this part of the world. And we, as an institution, have been trying to network with most of the institutions that are holding data. And what we have come to realize, as much as we want to come up with a lot of actually be able to publish most of the data that we have in the country. Being an organization that is not generating as much data becomes a challenge. And the other thing is it is a bit expensive to come up with this facility. So how can you help us in terms of probably getting funding to start this initiative? Or what are some of the mentorship that you can give so that you can be able to pick it up and we move on so that we can be able to bring out the large resources that we have in terms of biodiversity? The other thing is our institution has been mandated by the Ministry of Environment to come up with the biodiversity atlas of Kenya. That work is in progress, it's being financed by the ministry. And we're still facing a lot of challenges with data sharing, because even the agents that you're working with, they are still like doubtful. Why is it that it is an NGO that is going to is being given this assignment, yet we have government agencies that have a lot of data, but then they have not been given that work. So without the trust bit of it, it is almost impossible to accomplish anything. So how did you overcome this trust business so that you can be able to allow people to share it?
Okay, on your first question, in a very solid way, this course is a first step in terms of, you asked basically how can I help? I'm just a university professor, okay? So, how can I help personally? Well, all of the data at my institution, if it's in any way pertinent to your interests, we don't have a large GSTAT for a couple of things, but we have some. It's online, you can get to it right now. So in the data sense, I've done my part, and I'm very, you know, I sleep well at night, right? In the sense of building collaboration, I'm really happy with these courses. I was very, very excited to organize the proposal on the ground and then see that the foundation saw fit to fund it. And if nothing else, I get to meet all of you guys, I get to work with good friends and colleagues, and hope that you guys also go home with some new capability. So that sort of training and building capacity is one piece of the problem. Now, we brought up the word funding. That's hard for certainly, we should be looking at national sources. I don't know the landscape in Kenya. But also, we can certainly look at JRS Biodiversity Foundation. In fact, the grant that is funding this workshop and coming workshops is a very unusual one because the PI was not located based in Africa. So that foundation is very focused on African researchers. Now, ideally, you'll take some of the ideas that I gave you, and you'll think, okay, we need to build partnerships, we need to look across institutions, look across countries, and figure out what is the, essentially, the functional unit that can do this study best. It's not just the National Museum of Kenya. It's not the biggest data provider for Kenya was the U.S. It's not just National Museums of Kenya plus U.S. Who else has data? How can we make that happen? Okay, it's a partnership with the British Museum. So, I guess what I'm doing is I'm throwing the funding challenge back to you, because we're all in that program. Well, you've been in this workshop. I've been working on proposals for our National Institutes of Health. I have the same worries that you have. Obviously, I'm willing to help in any way I can. Now, some thinking about how do you take on these challenges, even if maybe you can't share data yet or you haven't convinced people yet. I do have some suggestions. It's not a requirement to share data. So one very interesting way we were talking over here about how do you convince your supervisor or your director. Well, maybe one very interesting way is to take the data that other people have shared, combine those data with the data that you have that you haven't shared, and do some good science. Produce some publications. But always bear in mind that science was better because somebody shared data, and remind the decision makers of that at the end of the day. This study, it's data from our institution, but it's also data from 16 other institutions in 12 countries who share the data. So that's part of that psychological transition we need to kind of lead them through. Okay? Then one other little tidbit that I throw out, this is something that we did for the Mexican bird office. When the question is put to the big biodiversity collections institutions that perhaps have the older, very important data, let's say from Kenya, if you ask them, why aren't all your data digital and accessible? Oftentimes the first excuse, the first reason is we don't have the funds to be able to do the capture, right? Data capture, my friend in Mexico calculated over the whole Conavio effort, $10 per specimen capture. I think that can be lowered massively, even if it's one phone. It's a lot of money, right? If it's a million specimens, right? So, what does that money get spent on? It gets spent on people. Now, in Kenya, you may not have huge resources, but you do have people. And so you can imagine a partnership, I'll just throw this out just for fun, a partnership with the British Museum, where 20 Kenyan undergrads go and image specimen ratings for all the plants in two botanical gardens, or all the birds in the British Museum from East Africa, or from Kenya. And a larger group of students might then participate in capturing the data. So you may not have big monetary resources, but you have very big people resources. And so that sort of partnership can be very powerful. In the Mexico example, we had in the science faculty of the National University, we had lots of undergraduates who needed to do, it's called a social service component, and then a senior thesis. And so we took a whole generation of those students in the zoology museum, and we sent them to museums across North America and Europe. And the ones that didn't have their data digital, either at the museum or bringing back images or catalogs, we captured the data. It was 420,000 records. Some of it was digital, and the curator was very kindly and just passed us a copy, and some of it we captured. Probably about half of it we captured. So that sort of model, think about it, at the end of the day, the British Museum or whatever the institution is, I'm not thinking of them. British Museum can say, look, we have all our East African collections computerized. And you guys can say, look, we have all this data. And both of you can say, because this is an international collaboration, we're sharing the data. So think very creative. And many times the most creative solution will be the one that gives you just ideas. You have to see what's possible and what's appropriate. Are there anybody else? Any question here?
Thank you again. Through the discussion, I heard that there's a lot of advantage to using GBEIF. But through your experience, what do you think there is the disadvantage by using this GBEIF?
He works for GBEIF.
I think we have to be very honest and very clear about what are the advantages and what are the disadvantages at each stage. So the highest level question is, what are the disadvantages of sharing your data? Okay? And in that sense, we're talking about these questions about, can somebody else grab my data? Use it for something that I was going to do. I think we've talked about that. Is your question, why GDIF and why not some other platform? To be honest, I've dedicated the last 15 years of my life to the idea of open sharing of biodiversity data, and I wouldn't put 15 years of my life into it if I didn't believe that this is the right thing to do. That doesn't mean that there aren't problems, and there aren't little failings, and there aren't little details, but it's the right thing to do. Which is to say, data that you cover up and hide are not science, they're not data, as far as I'm concerned, they don't exist. Okay? That's my extremist position. My idea is science is a matter of trust. That's why we publish, right? If I publish something, you can take those ideas and use them in your publication. So science is all about trust. I'm trusting that you're going to read my paper, hoping that you're going to read my paper, and I'm trusting that you're going to cite me. You don't have to. You probably should, but you don't have to. It's just like open data. So, to me, in the biggest sense, there is no disadvantage. Okay? In the middle sense, you know, why GBIF and why not VertNet or why not SABIF or why not some network that you would create? Each network has its little details. For example, VertNet doesn't do non-vertebrates. Okay, it's a vertebrate network. I want a network that does life, because I might want to know about the mammal and the foot. US focused. Not all of it, and in fact, they now have the freedom to do some global work. GBIF, my personal criticism of GBIF, as I've said before in public, is that there hasn't been enough focus on fitness for use of data. There's been a lot of focus on getting the data shared, which is admirable, and now we need to see a big push on making those data maximum quality, clean, improve, georeference, flagged as far as quality. That's nothing new, that comment's been around. So each of these initiatives has its little fail